Hare Krishna Radhesham Prabhu, please welcome to the Monks Podcast.
Now, Hare Krishna.
It's a long cherished desire to have you here, and I'm grateful that you could spare the time today to join.
Thank you.
And the entire culture of serious spiritual discussions I learned from you. You know, when I was in Pune, you spent a lot of time answering questions, and then when we were doing classes together in youth outreach, you know, we would discuss how to present concepts, how to answer questions. So I think the taste for philosophical discussion, I have got it from you. So I'm grateful that you are here today. And I thought today we could discuss about the topic which I know is it's very dear to your heart, as well as you have done landmark contribution in this. It is making spiritual knowledge relevant to the youth. So I'll start with some questions, and then you can share your thoughts.
Yeah.
Thank you.
One of my interests in reaching out to youths is to see, you know, very intelligent youths like you reaching out the message of spirituality to the whole world. When you were in Pune, I remember in the very early days, you became a writer in Speaking Tree. I have never seen somebody writing 50 articles in Speaking Tree. You know, in those days, we used to think that Speaking Tree means was one article in 5 years. But you wrote in 1 year so many articles. So I used to always think that the intelligentsia of India is going all across the globe for further studies in MS and PhD, and people become technical business magnates. And they are running big industries across the globe. Some intelligence of India, the Brahminical intelligence, should also become utilized in studying Gita and spreading across the globe. And you are doing it through the Gita Daily nowadays. Every day people are opening their smartphones and reading your Gita Daily articles. I feel very joyful to see that. So I feel that this kind of outreach that you are doing is reaching to nook and corner of the world. So the young Indians' intelligence should actually spread the Vedic wisdom like a lighthouse giving light to the ships in the ocean, ocean of the samsara. So India is a spiritual capital of the whole world, and you are actually doing such a valuable piece of work all across the globe. I am very grateful to you, and I'm very appreciative, and I feel proud of having the opportunity to be one of your colleagues in the same ashrama in your early days of practice in Pune.
Your humility is heartbreaking, actually. You were my guide and mentor, and I still see you as one of my most prominent spiritual teachers. So, taking this forward, how did you become inspired to focus on youth outreach? Was it something which, even in your pre-devotional days, you had a zeal for sharing wisdom with others, or it was primarily after you were introduced to Krishna consciousness?
One of the primary inspirations for this came in my engineering days. In my first year engineering, my father actually brought me to Chennai and told me that since you are from a Brahmin family, I want to see you staying safely with Brahmanas, good association. So he identified two Brahmin boys staying in one room and requested them, can you please take my son and keep with you so that his character and good values should be preserved. And they agreed. So I joined their room. But within a couple of days, I came to know that they are Brahmins in name only. But they used to bring in suitcase all liquor bottles. They were reading pornography books. They were smoking and getting into all kinds of dirty habits. And I was shell-shocked to see that. Although they are born in Brahmin families, they have a sacred thread, but they indulge in all kinds of impure habits. And when I went to my college also, I saw students suffering from drinking after the exam results would come. So at that time, one type of very strong urge arose in me that actually we should teach the modern day youth, you know, leading a very clean life, life free from bad habits. That's one thing. And after that first year of stay with these fellows, in fact, by Lord's grace, I could preserve my purity living with them. I learned from them what not to do. That's what they taught me. And in the second year, and third year and fourth year, I got a very good companion, one Krishna Kumar. Right now, he is in a very senior position in Rashtriya Sanskrit Association, which is propagating Sanskrit all over the country So he's in a very active role there. So he and me, we both stayed together. And then we used to walk for our prasadam to one Sri Vaishnava's house. So he would always every day tell me 2-3 words from Vishnu Sahasranama, names of Lord Vishnu, and explain to me the meanings. He came from a very pious family. So in his company, I could also advance in my devotional service. Prior to that, in my 7th, 8th standard and all, we used to have a lot of spiritual books from various organizations. And I had a group of 25 students during my 7th. We used to come together for spiritual discussions like that. Of course, we were not very clear about what the ultimate truth is and what is God and what is the goal of life. We were not very clear. We were very sure about one thing, that spirituality is very vital. You know, material pleasure is not all in all. The material pleasures are actually often deceptive, you know. And we actually used to discuss about how to control the urges like lust, anger, greed in us, and also help others also to rise above them and develop devotion to God. So we used to put up festivals for God, as well as at the same time discuss about overcoming the lower urges. These were some of the discussions we used to have. So when I met this boy, it was a very nice company for me. So when I came to IIT Bombay, when I was studying, what really took me by surprise was Americans, for the first time they came to the campus, I saw, you know, tall and shaven-headed and wearing saffron and taking mridangam, kartal, books, and then giving a lecture. It was very, very inspiring. Yeah.
Sorry, before you get to introduction to Krishna conscious devotees, a little backtracking. So it seems your upbringing was not just like nominally religious. Your upbringing was also quite spiritual, isn't it? You seem to have a very clear understanding of the values to live by. So overall, how was the your atmosphere in your home? Was it like devotional, ritual, or philosophical? Or how was it?
Actually, my father had done, you know, many English degrees, like MA, MPhil. And he was very fond of Shakespeare, you know, Charles Dickens, Oliver Goldsmith, you know, Emerson, Henry David Thoreau, and this kind of authors. So he collected thousands of books practically at home, few thousands of books he had. So in my school days, he would give me five books to complete. It would be like, you know, Ulysses, you know, like Jonathan Swift's Gulliver's Travels. You know? Like that, he would give me a few books. I would read and then give it back to him. So he was building my values and morals in my early days. And also I was living in a village setup where many Brahmins were living in one lane. And we had a Vishnu temple. We would go regularly and hear Ramayana Katha, Mahabharata Katha there also. So both spirituality and morality were actually embedded in our lives. Not only me, there were about 20 to 30 students in our lane. We were all friends together. So that's how we were brought up in our very early days in our village. When I came to 5th standard, we moved from village to town. And then that seed which I got in the early stage helped me to look for more spiritual knowledge and philosophical knowledge. Actually, me and my friends were more on the philosophical side. Discussing about meaning of life, goal of life, why this world is created, who is God, is God personal or impersonal, why these lower natures are dragging us down, these kind of things. Yeah.
So it seems you're not only was you had a religious or devotional upbringing, but also you had a wide reading exposure. So I think for somebody living in a village to read so many, not just contemporary Western authors, but classical Western authors, that's not so common in India.
So actually, my father was an extensive reader. I have read a few books, I can say. My father was actually into English. He was a head of the Department of English in a government arts college for 35 years.
Okay.
He was teaching English and mathematics. So because of that, he would inspire me also to read. And we both have written also some of the essay contests, like CS, that competition success review. You know,
okay.
He would write contests. And so there was a lot of encouragement I got in literature. Studying and learning, and that gradually inclination towards spiritual literature increased over a period of time after that. Yeah.
Oh, so even writing was a habit which you had at that time. Eventually, you become a prolific writer in bhakti. So even writing, the roots also were from quite a young age for you.
Actually, my father would correct my grammar always. When I would write, I would give it for evaluation. Then we both will send it to the magazines. So we would do that. Yeah.
So in one sense, everything in your life was preparing you for the time when you came to IIT Mumbai, and then you saw, as you said, you saw the devotees there. So can you describe what was it that attracted you about them?
One of the first things that attracted me was that Westerners are actually taking to the knowledge of Bhagavad Gita and practicing it and preaching it, you know, although they have very, I mean, their culture is quite different in the Western world. For them to come to India and live in this equatorial climate, you know, hot climate, and wearing the robes of a saint and, you know, adopting to the Indian scenario here, you know, where the kind of, you know, facilities and amenities are not as much as they have it in their country, which is pretty lavish for them. Mm. So they have sacrificed their lavish facilities. You know, they have given up their motherland and they have come to India here. And they have adapted the Vedic culture wholeheartedly, not just superficially. It is not lip service or something. There are even many Indians who once in a week or so go to some temple and ring a bell. But rest of the time, they are absorbed in their, you know, material progress, you know, just money making and, you know, career making. And they don't have much time for God. But these people have given their lives to God totally. So that really deeply touched me. And when I went to the class, I heard them speak Sanskrit verses eloquently. So I actually, in my third standard, once when I was walking on the road, I heard the Sahana Bhavatu verse. Sahana Bhavatu, Sahanam Punaktu. So the dissertation really touched my heart. So I requested my father, why don't you put me in this Gurukula instead of that school? But my father said, see, you come from a well-to-do family. You know, we will call a Gurukul teacher to come and teach you at home, he said. Some mantras you can learn like this, no problem. Vishnu Sahasranama Stotram and all, we will, you know, train you in that. And you don't have to go to Gurukul and join that. You become an engineer or a doctor, you know. And these things you can learn side by side, he had told me at that time. And then he told me, after becoming a doctor, if you still have a desire to be a monk, I will not stop you. Then you can go ahead in life. He was a very open-minded man, my father. Okay. So therefore, when I saw these people, I felt that this is what I should be doing. And I was thinking, if I just become an IT engineer and just make a good amount of money and fill up my pocket and I maintain a small family, then what about the millions and millions of suffering souls in this world who are actually suffering? I already knew by the time, because I had gone to a dozen organizations before that. I know about cycle of birth and death. I know about the transfer of soul from one body to another. I know about moksha. I wanted to be more clear about what is the ultimate moksha. I wasn't very clear about that at that time. So I knew very well that in this world, the goal of life is not just earning bread and butter. The goal of life is not to chase after the mirage of glitter and glamour. The goal of life is actually to attain perfection of the ananda, which is annamaya, pranamaya, manomaya, vijnanamaya, anandamaya. So, and what is that anandamaya state? Is it a standstill state of peace? Or is it meeting the personality of Godhead and exchanging love with Him? So those kind of questions I had at the time when I was meeting these people. And then seeing them very eloquent in their scriptural study and in their practice. So two things at that time very much attracted me to ISKCON in their training programs. One is, you know, in ISKCON, they teach you to utilize all your senses in Lord's service rather than, you know, denying the senses. Like many other organizations taught us to go to Himalayas or, you know, very much restrictive, you know, shut your senses or deny your senses. It's self-denial process. Whereas in ISKCON, I found that with your eyes, you can see the beautiful deities. With your ears, you can hear beautiful songs and hear lectures. So this kind of engaging senses is one thing I liked very much. Another thing I liked very much in ISKCON society is, I always thought in my life that I should not attain liberation alone, myself. You know, I should do some good for the other suffering souls also. Why should I selfishly think about my own moksha? That is some kind of selfishness. I clearly knew that even before. And when I came to ISKCON, precisely it hit me really hard when I learned that in Prahlad Maharaj, Shripad Ramanujacharya, you know, Haridas Thakur, Vasudev, they all actually have taught about how to work for liberating the suffering people in this world and take them all back to the spiritual abode. That really, like, resonating with my heart when I heard that. So Srila Prabhupada repeatedly says we should live in the heart of the city and we should do welfare work for the people. And supreme welfare is to connect all the orphan children who have turned away from God back to God and make them supremely happy. The goal of our organization is to make everyone supremely happy. So somebody is in a small house of 5-6 members. somebody identifies with their caste people, somebody identifies with state people or country people. As our love expands, it's called love agape, we call it, which is a universal love. Universal love is actually a love for not only humans, but all creatures. As Lord Krishna says, Sarva Yonashikante. And that really touched my heart. Krishna is the father, all jivas are his eternal children, and Vasudhayeva Kutumbakam. And ultimately, he wants to see all the suffering souls come from material plane to spiritual plane. And that really clicked for me very well. I understood this is what I want to do.
Oh, that's amazing. So you could say that what you had, the values which you had already learned, you got further inspiration and direction about how to channel all those through your association with devotees.
Yeah.
And then more clarity, more energy. Mm-hmm. So specifically, how did you get into, you focus on youth outreach? Was it just because you were introduced as a youth to spirituality, so you naturally felt inspired to continue that?
After I completed my studies and joined the temple in Bombay in 1994, when I joined the temple, I was given one of the first services of Spiritual Scientist magazine to, you know, print the magazine and publish it. And every month, distribute it also, you know. So it was like, to begin with, we were doing 500, you know, then later on about 1,000 magazines. So I had to raise some funds for it also, for getting it printed. There was one Chaitanya Vallabh Prabhu in Bombay who was helping us with some donations also. And we would collect, and then we would get the articles written, printed, published, and then reaching out to various addresses, maintain databases, big service at that time. In those days, later on, when you took up that service of Spiritual Scientist, you made it an e-sign also, and then it virally went all over the world, thousands and lakhs of people watching it. In the early days, it was going to have 1,000, 2,000 people. So that was one of my very early day services. Another service was to go to college preaching. So I was doing college preaching also. These two were main, and also rolling chapatis for the devotees in the kitchen. And doing some service in the deity department, cutting fruits for the deities. Radha Gopinath would be pujari, and I'll be assisting him cutting the fruits. So these kind of services I was doing. So that was the time I felt that the youth preaching... So before I joined in 94, I was working in Pune between 92 and 93. So that was the time I was staying in Negdi, where I was working in Thermax company. And in my room, I started some youth activities, youth preaching activities there. So eventually we found that the 20, 30 youth started regularly coming and getting connected and attending morning programs and then evening. Then I would go to the Negdi Krishna temple and put a book table there. In the book table, many intelligent people would come and purchase books and ask questions also. One of the people who came for the book table was a very brilliant boy with a spark in his eyes, very intelligent boy. I requested him to write an article on vegetarianism. The next week, he brought a 10-page article. He wrote it, brought it. On a rainy day, he came with an umbrella and gave it. And that was a boy who later on became Gaur Gopal Prabhu.
Amazing. Okay.
And similarly, many other people, Sundar Krishna Prabhu and people... So I understood one thing, putting book table and reaching to the youth in the temples is one thing. And also going to the, you know, houses and conducting program where both youths and congregation were coming like that. So that's where my interest was generated. And then when I joined the temple, as well as Bhakti Sam Maharaj told from Ranath Maharaj that Rajasham has been doing youth preaching, it would be nice to put him in youth preaching, like that they were told. So 95, I was sent to Pune. Just after 1 year of 3 months. So in Pune, both GBCs, my spiritual master from Ranath Maharaj and my GBC of Pune from Puja Gopalakrishna Goswami Maharaj, both of them at two different times told me to do youth preaching separately. And from Ranath Maharaj wrote a letter to me when I reported to him about what's happening in Pune. So he gave eight-point instruction one by one. In that, he told me that college students should be encouraged to complete their academic studies. And they should not leave the studies in between. Let them complete it. At the same time, they should practice Krishna consciousness side by side along with their studies. And he also had mentioned that you should emphasize on the philosophy and as well as the practices, as well as the Vaishnava culture. So Siddhanta, Swadhyaya, I mean, Sadachar, they should be taught to be engaged in Seva. And at the same time, they should be performing their duty to parents. Everything should be balanced. A very, very beautiful letter. So that became like a blueprint for me. And then I started in Pune, and things were booming over the years by Lord's grace. It built up from 1995 to 2003. So 2001, we had coined the term BACE, BACE, Bhaktivedanta Academy for Culture and Education. Then eventually, after 3-4 years, I found that the BACE term became very prominent, and many other temples started using it also. But the problem was, the BACE term was used more like a place where youths congregate, stay together, and take prasadam. That became BACE in some places. People just stay together, have a cook. The cooker cooks nice prasad. They take prasad, go to college or school, and come back. But the morning programs were not very much emphasized. Philosophical training program in some places across the country. And at the time, we designed a new name called VOICE. VOICE, Vedic Oasis for Inspiration, Culture and Education. So that it will have its uniqueness, it will have its purity standards, it will have its very well documented goals and objectives, vision goals that we did that. We saw the preaching expanding very powerfully. Various leaders came to the preaching. By the grace of Vaishnavas in Pune temple, we have a community of 6,000 members, all married people, married community members. Approximately 500 celibates have not only come through Pune, they joined, they were all sent to different parts of the country. Almost 14 different temples. They were, I guess, to some temples we sent 25, 30. To some temples we sent even 40 or 43 also, one of the temples. Some temples we sent about 15, like that. I clearly told them in 2001, the goal is every Indian ISKCON temple should have 50 brahmacharis and 1,000 congregations. I told them that. To that effect, whatever we can do, we will do. So say, for example, I am sending 10 brahmacharis to one temple. So, but then they will go there and preach and everybody make a talk for a period of time. So just picturize that in your mind, how wonderful it will be. Every temple has 1,000 congregation and, 40, 50 celibate devotees staying and taking care of the lordships and preaching and distributing books and everything. So in this way, we will have a very nice, and India, Prabhupada says, is actually a spiritual capital of the whole world. And then later on, these temples can cater the needs of all the other temples worldwide. They can help and assist in propagating. Like Srila Prabhupada himself went in his old age to preach in America. So we also want many, many educated Indians who have either become good grihasthas or Brahma. Even grihasthas, I would say, after the age of 50, grihasthas, husband and wife, can become international preachers. You know, they can actually, their sons and daughters are grown up and they can actually take care of their business. Then 50, 60, you have earned out some money, you know, put it in the bank and then go around the world and preach. Those are especially Indians. And those are brahmacharis, they can take sannyas and they can also go around the world and preach. So it'll be very nice missionary lifestyle, which this is what Srila Prabhupada wanted, yeah.
Yes, bro. So actually, in one sense, from Pune, you have been able to demonstrate I would say, at least in the contemporary ISKCON history, a new way to build a community. Quite often the focus is on, say, building a temple or focus on book distribution. All these also have eventually happened in Pune in quite phenomenal ways. But the idea of, say, having a focusing on youth and taking the youth outreach as the crux of the community, as the nerve or the vibrant center of the community.
Exactly.
So was because this?
From youth, brahmacharis come. From youth, congregation, grihastha, husband, wives come. And when their wives come, they do children preaching. And they do girls preaching, wives. So they bring the girls, they bring the children. In fact, we have almost 60 couples in Pune who are leaders, called counselors. Within the counselor system, we have about 4,500 people. 4,500 people we have. And then another 1,500 are upcoming devotees. So in this way, we see that over a period of time, the cream leaders are the ones who ultimately take care of the community congregation. But the temple brahmacharis, they stay in the temple. They cater to various categories. Boys from the age group of 10 to 18, we call teenage boys. And then 18 to 25, we have the boys voice and everything. And those boys who are working, We call it as a yoga group. We call it, yoga stands for youth of God's abode. So we have one group for them also. And then they get into married life by 27, 28, they join the congregation. So, and the children below 10 are taken care by the ladies. The temple is like the cart.
Through the youth outreach, everything that is required for a community develops. In one sense, if I was thinking that Srila Prabhupada also started like that, isn't it? In America, Prabhupada focused first on individuals. And then eventually temples were built and Rath Yatras happened and everything happened.
Yeah.
So I think what you're saying about putting the horse before the cart, that's what. So Prabhupada was not exactly doing college outreach, but he was also youth outreach in a different way. Because most
in New York, in New York, many, many people became celibates. And in San Francisco, almost all became grihastha couples.
Yes.
In Prabhupada's teaching. So both types of people he got.
Yes, for you. So now when you are talking about the youth center's voice, so typically what did you feel are the challenges that the youth face in taking up spirituality? Taking up, because at one level it's India's own culture, it is India's own wisdom. But what are the obstacles that they face in coming to, in embracing say Bhagavad Gita's wisdom? And how do we facilitate them in removing the obstacles for them?
Okay. In our experience, I can tell you there are so many years of experience. And there are different type of youths. Like we find that majority of youths, because of the media madness, you know, the smartphone, you know, where they watch different type of YouTube movies, you know, they play video games. And all the time you find them with the smartphone. And the smartphone nowadays, especially the pornography, so this is one category of youths who get carried away by the glitter and glamour of the world outside through the media madness. This is one category which actually carries them away. I observe that. That means, you know, we can say immediate pleasures, petty pleasures, you know, the glitter and glamour attracts the one category of youth. Then there are others who are not after just the enjoyment in life, not just eat, drink, be merry. There's a little more serious category. They are more academics oriented. They think that in India, the university pattern, the examination dates are all unpredictable. There's uncertainty and unpredictability. And they're all the time in tension about, you know, writing assignments and writing tests. Nowadays, it's increasing more and more. Load is increasing, academic load. In fact, IIT Hyderabad, three boys jumped off from a building, I mean, committing suicide. Because nowadays, academic pressures are increasing and job placements have reduced. So there's a lot of worry about job placement, worry about academic pressures. So then where is time for spirituality? They are most of the time worried about academics. So that is one category of people we find. And then we also find people's, you know, suspicion, you know, doubt in accepting the authority of God, religion, scriptures. You know, people have become agnostics because of global, you know, now there is a, like the whole world is called the global village. Now everybody is connected to everybody else in the village through the net. Now people know all over the world. So like many Americans are coming to India to learn the Vedic culture. And now Indians want to go to America to enjoy the Western culture. You find like that. Like, you know, India, we can say is like a spiritual capital or a spiritual lighthouse, I told you. You know, America has a Statue of Liberty. It's a country which actually teaches freedom of speech, freedom of thought, freedom of action. So Indians sometimes feel, boys feel restricted in India. They want to go there and experience freedom. And Americans have already experienced the freedom. They want to come to India and learn self-restraint. You know, they are more interested. They come here and our people go there, you know. So going abroad, getting placed in good jobs, making a lot of money, enjoying life, you know, eat, drink and be merry, that becomes many main goal. Now, there are youths who are pious, coming from pious families and also a little inclined to spirituality. So we have a very good series of programs, beginning with a course called Discover Yourself. First, we do one-time program in the college on topics like power of habits, you know, or stress management, or art of harnessing mind power, which is done for like 500 or 800 students. We do. You yourself have done a program in NIT Rourkela, the Beat the Mind. 1,000 boys attended. That is the biggest program we have done till now. You know, where you know, 1,000 students, 4-digit number attending under one roof, which you did yourself. So this type of programs we do in the colleges. And then after that, we don't chase after uninterested people. We only, you know, very well, according to Vedic life also, there are four categories of people. We call it Tata, we call it teachers, administrators, traders, artisans. So in these four people,
okay.
Yeah, the artisans should learn loyalty. The traders should learn morality. The administrators should learn religiosity. And the teachers should learn spirituality. So loyalty, morality, religiosity and spirituality. So what is religiosity? Religiosity is not just some rituals or rites. They should actually, you know, protect the dharma in the country. Dharma also includes respect for women, you know, protection of the cows, protection of children, you know, protection of old people, and protection of the teachers of the wisdom of the Vedic literature. So therefore, if you see these three or four categories, in a typical Vedic community, there will be, if you take 1,000 people community, you know, there will be, you know, one Brahmana at the top, you know, like one Brahmana, and 9 Kshatriyas, you know, and 90 Vaishyas, and 900 Shudras, like we call it, four categories, which means one teacher and 9 administrators and 90
traders,
and 900 artisans.
Okay.
Like that. So if you take a typical Vedic community, therefore, the spirituality is most easily understood by the teachers level, which is actually very, therefore, even Srila Prabhupada said, all over the world, even if, you know, 5% or 10% of the people take to Krishna consciousness, the whole world can be happy. He said, because they will spread good vibration through the administrators. So the kings or administrators can do, see, the difference between administrators and teachers is what? Teachers are advisors, administrators are actors. Like, you know, Krishna is giving advice, Arjuna is acting. Like that.
Yes. Yeah.
So these two people combined, they can actually do great good to society. So therefore, we also in our preaching, we want to see that those who are actually having refined culture, coming, you know, those who have a spiritual inquiry, you know. So if they come to our programs and learn, even if the number is small, we don't worry. But we see that there's a good number of people having such inclination also.
The administrators and the teachers, they can actually transform society.
Exactly.
Yes, sir. So you are, in a sense, you are very, what struck me about what you explained is two things. First, you talked about how there's a structured program for everyone, but you also have a clear vision about whom you are targeting.
Yeah.
Who's the target audience.
Yeah.
So, from your experience, although you have a specific target audience, even that is not small. There are a significant number of students who are of the inclination of teachers and administrators.
Yeah. Actually, another good thing that happened by Lord's grace is that we are not confining only to Pune. You know, we have devotees sent to Calcutta, Kanpur, you know, Bangalore, Hyderabad, different place, parts of the country. So just like, you know, if a tree is producing some fruits and then you take the seeds and you sow the seeds elsewhere, then they all grow trees also. It multiplies. It has a multiplication effect. Because they all put their efforts. In fact, they grow better in another place than getting choked in one small place. Too many people trying to do big thing in a small place. So when they were given opportunity and they are all doing very nicely in their respective places. Now, if you see all over the world, there are two things everybody is looking for. Eco-friendly environment. Eco-friendly environment and eco-friendly relationships.
It's beautifully put. Okay.
Because for health, what do we want? For good health, we need eco-friendly environment. Even people working in IT company go to the garden and sit with the laptop in the garden and they're taking a deep breath. They don't like a synthetic office, isn't it? Similarly, people are looking for eco-friendly environment, but ego-friendly relationships with people. So you will see in our training program, we focus on, you know, good health, good habits, you know, values, character, and loving relationships. So these kind of things we emphasize in our training program. So when body has a good, when they have a good health and good habits, then the mind is peaceful. A healthy mind and a healthy body. say, you know. So people eat pure food, you know, they lead a life free from vices like meat eating, gambling, intoxication, illicit sex, you know. Then they have pure habits. So they have good health, they have pure habits, then that leads to a very peaceful mind. Yeah. And then they'll be able to focus on living a life based on values and character, values, morals, ethics, character. With all these things, then spirituality becomes something within their grasp. Yeah. That becomes a springboard for them to, from there, jump to the spiritual understanding. The spiritual understanding is anandamaya state. One requires a very cheerful and peaceful disposition of the mind to be able to focus on that. Modern day youths are actually, struggling with their body and mind, not knowing the right path. So therefore, our presentation of philosophy is the most relevant to them, to their lives. Ours is such a beautiful and pure lifestyle. Our youths actually sleep by 9, get up by 3, latest by 9:30. Get up at 3:34 in the morning, 6 hours they sleep. They eat the purest of the food. It is not only hygienically cooked, it's offered, it's a karma-free diet. It's offered to the Lord, so they eat pure food. And like I remember, I had gone to one company seminar on stress management. They made the big managers with a coat, suit, tie and everything. They told them to run in the hall, touch that wall, touch this wall. Whoever does it 20 times and comes first, they'll get a prize, they said. So they made them run back and forth. And after 20, many of the managers are breathing heavily, running. And they gave them a gift also. And the speaker of the management seminar was telling, I wanted to bring out the child in you. He was telling, because you guys have become cooked up in your head with too much stress. I want to bring out the child in you. Huh? So many such techniques are used by management experts to bring out the child in us. But we have a program every morning which brings out child in us every day, which means, you know, to be enthusiastic, to be cheerful, to be dancing, to be singing. So our boys do it every morning. They dance in circles, you know, they dance in formations. They sing. They also do meditation by chanting. You know, and they also hear a class, philosophical class for about half an hour, 40 minutes from the Gita. Every day, one shloka they hear. In this way, they are doing every aspect of a human personality is taken care. Because if you take care of only the body, somebody is going for gym and keeping a very healthy body, looking body, or jogging, or, you know, aerobic exercise. Many people do different exercises. That's like we call them as a good animal because they only take care of the body. But if somebody keeps very good relationship with family members and friends, you can call them as a good friend. Somebody keeps, somebody is very expert in their profession. You call them as a good craftsman. And somebody connects with God through prayer every day. You call them as a good saint. And if you take all the four aspects, you know, good animal, good friend, good craftsman, and good saint, this makes a complete human being. And that is our training. Our training is not one-sided. People have wrong notion that spirituality means all the time you chase after God. You don't do other things. Actually, we balance. We have a study chart for the college studies also. Many of our boys who were 7 graders became 9.5, 9.8 graders in just a matter of staying just 1 year. In fact, many of the university toppers are devotees also. Many of the university toppers, department toppers in computer science and such departments. The reason is we just don't, you know, in a go in a one-sided way for spirituality. We keep a balance of everything.
That's fascinating. So as you said, that sometimes people's perception is that spirituality will make us too impractical or otherworldly. So what you are saying is that by spiritual practices, a person can even become more competent in their material life because of their regulated lifestyle and good habits and good health.
Very naturally. Most of the students, I remember when I was in IIT days, you know, the students would call me for eating out in a Woodlands hotel in the campus. One boy called me at 12:30 at night. I said, 12:30, you're going to eat now? He said, yes. Now we are going in a group. Come on, you also join us. I said, I have a fixed time for eating. We have morning, afternoon and evening we eat. So boys have very bad eating habits, sleeping habits, pre-mixing with the opposite sex. And also, in order to forget their tension and stress, they drink and they smoke and they take to drugs. And modern day students are really suffering very terribly. And our movement actually can teach them, first of all, to lead a very regulated and pure lifestyle by which they will feel even material happiness. Right now, people don't even know how to materially become happy also. in the name of becoming happy, they are actually increasing the sufferings. It is actually worsening their situation, but they are imagining it to be happiness, in the name of happiness. So therefore, in our training program, we give due attention to every aspect of life.
And overall, when we have this this program, so how did you evolve the idea of a voice and creating a structured program? So did you, based on your experience of living in a college and sharing bhakti at that time, is because that is, I think, the specific idea of a center associated or dedicated specifically for not just youths to come and attend programs, but to live together. That is itself a significant, we could say, adaptation, which has been very powerful in helping youth take up spirituality. So how did you come up with that vision or that particular idea?
This idea, the first time in 1996, when there were a group of 6 students in the early days, you know, they were becoming devotees. So the first thought came to me, because I was very fond of Gurukul. I told you, in my third standard, I saw the Gurukul boys. So I thought that Gurukula is the best place where, you know, children come together who are spiritual minded. They come together, you know, they take only prasadam, they lead a clean life. And also Prabhupada says in his nectar instruction and all, like in Chamber of Commerce, all the stock exchange people come together. Mm-hmm. You know, birds of the same feather flock together.
Okay.
So keeping that in mind, I had gathered five to six people in the beginning, and they stayed together, and we went to give a program. And I found that for the weekly program, they get 40 people for the weekly program. These are only 5-6 people. Each of them call their friend 5-5-6-6. Yeah. So I felt that these 5-6 people are like brahmanas. I told you, spiritual. They can understand spirituality well. But the next 30-40 people who come, they may either be administrators or they may become traders. So if they become administrators, they can also assist in expanding the movement. And if they become traders, they can fund our programs. They can assist in sponsoring our events and all. So they brought people like that. So we understand that even if 40-50 people come, at the end of the day, you may get about 10. Like, I have a very simple formula. We start with 400-500 people in the college, one-time program we do. At the end of the year, people who stay in our center, we get about 10 people. That's all. 10 committed, dedicated. So first year I get 10, second year I get 20, total 20, and then total 30. So in a given center, in 4 years of preaching, you can have about 30 to 40 people staying. And then they will start passing out also, like that. So we don't aim at a very big number. And out of this, we find maybe 2 may want to dedicate their lives fully in 2 or 3 max. And the others, 6-7 people, and sometimes even 8 also may want to become grihasthas, married. So the number may appear small. People may say, oh, they may get discouraged also. That's all. But in the long run, it has a multiplied effect. If you work on quality, you get quality quantity for a period of time.
Yes. So there's a nice point. So if you focus on quality initially, and there's a multiplier effect, because year after year, things are going on.
Yeah.
So when you chose to focus on youth outreach,
yeah,
I have been traveling across the world, and of course, in the other parts of in America and UK and Australia, the challenges are significantly different. They're much more for youth outreach, but youth outreach itself requires a significant investment of resources, not in terms of time, energy, devotee resources. So, how does this start? I mean, so you say you have started doing it you did it in Pune. But other temples have also taken it up over the years.
Yeah, correct.
Because in general, we also look for, say, if you're putting in efforts, what are the results that come in? So youth outreach takes at least maybe half a decade or more to provide.
It takes considerable time. It depends on the leaders of the temples only. Certainly in Pune, I was a president on one hand. I was also the youth preacher. So because of which I could balance both. It was easy. In some temples, the youth preachers are different and temple president is different. And sometimes their interest may be different also. Temple leaders may want some life patrons to donate money to the temple. And they may want that more, instead of youths taking 7-8 years to dedicate their lives or become committed grihasthas. It takes time, certainly. Only, like we say, you know, one should be actually looking for One should be able to have a, like Deergadarshi, we say, long-term vision one should have. Only then one can appreciate this. But the temples have seen across the country in India, I see the people have understood it's very valuable to have intelligent, educated devotees who are very humble, committed, and you know, very focused in Prabhupada's mission. Such people can do very great good to ISKCON society. In fact, many of these youths actually can run small preaching centers in different parts of the country. Eventually, ISKCON also has a plan to have 2,000 or 3,000 preaching centers in the country. Now, right now we have about 800 temples across the world, but eventually number of small mini centers are going to increase, and each mini center will require a good leader, capable leader, dedicated, committed devotee. You know, so many of these youths as grihasthas or brahmacharis, in whatever capacity they can, you know, they can actually lead the centers and do great good to the world. You know, why only people should just become doctors or engineers, lawyers, or chartered accountants? Why not some of the, even the Vedic times, the brahmanas were not only brahmacharis necessarily, some of them are grihasthas also. Similarly, we can also have grihastha leaders who are actually leading small preaching centers, and instead of going to a company and earning money, they actually distribute Prabhupada's books, they do Harinam Sankirtan, they cook prasadam and distribute, and people who come and hear the classes and they give classes. So people become inspired and they will actually fund the temple by charity centers. And this kind of, it can increase. In fact, Ramanuja Kutiram, if you hear in South India, I heard there are 5,000 cottages in South India made by Ramanuja. It was like, covered in the top with the pillars, you know, and open space, open thing. People can come and sit in the evening and do kirtan together and study Ramayana, Mahabharata, Bhagavatam, and books like that, you know. And people would gather together, satsanga. So that is the whole principle. People, unless they come together, if they are not coming together in the evening to discuss something spiritual, then they are going to have mundane engagements. People.
Okay.
So our goal is this: make circles of people. We have Bhagavatam study circles, you know, Bhagavad Gita study circle. In each circle, about 10 people come together and they study the spiritual books and get spiritually awakened. And once they are awakened, they will be light emitters. They will not be sufferers anymore. They will be wisdom emitters, light emitters, and they will do great good to the world.
That's true. So there's one thing about, sometimes people are especially concerned in India that we are making so many people into brahmacharis and they neglect their family responsibilities. So I think one thing which you, as far as I remember, you were one of the first persons to emphasize that in our movement, when we do youth, people who become brahmacharis, that they should actually, students should complete their family responsibilities and not just either abandon their education or abandon their family.
Correct.
So can you explain how this is done and what inspired you to focus on that aspect also?
Yeah, actually we teach people that mother and father are the first gods in life. And it is a fact actually. We say, you know, guru, first mata, then pita, then guru, then dev. In India, it is well known. So the child sees only mother who is a breastfeeding mother. Without drinking the breast milk of the mother, the child has no scope to grow at all in life. Child will perish actually without that. So the children should be taught first to respect the mother. Then the mother shows hand to the father. Then the father takes responsibility for the child and then educates him, grows him up, and then engages him in a job. And then the father shows hand to the guru and tells the boy, learn spirituality, learn good principles in life, what to do, what not to do from a Guruji. Then Guru shows hand to God. Guru shows that the ultimate goal of life is to go back to Godhead. And while executing your duties to go back to Godhead, you also have to balance, like Dharma should be balanced with Artha. Correct, no? Both should be balanced. Like when Narada met Yudhishthira, he asked him, are you doing only Artha at the cost of Dharma? Or you are doing only Dharma at the cost of Artha? Or you have shunned both Dharma and Artha for the sake of enjoying the petty pleasures of the world like that. So generally we teach this only, but it is seen that sometimes the boys are very outstanding in spirituality and they develop a very deep taste. Even in the first year, second year, they exhibit, because where does it come from? It comes from the previous lives. Krishna says that, Purvyabhyasenatenaivakriyatehiyavashopisahajignyasarapiyogasyashabdabrahmativartate. So then such people, we tell them that, okay, you have a lot of interest to dedicate your life, but not now. First you finish your studies, They finish their studies at 21. And we tell them to work for at least a few more years. They have to work and earn money to support the parents. So they work for about 4 or 5 years. And after that also, they have to ensure that their mother and father will never be alone and cared for at any time in their life. So no mother, father should suffer without food. And they should not be in the street or tomorrow coming to the son in the ashram saying, "You're better, you have no money, please help us." It shouldn't happen. And also, many of the boys have sisters. You know, parents are worried about the settlement of the sisters. Like I myself had 3 sisters. You know, I got them all married and settled. And my father actually was a pretty millionaire. He had, you know, he had a few crores of property. So money was not a big issue. But still I worked and earned some money and gave. So we don't admit anybody into the ashrama unless they show us in black and white paper clearly that my parents have sufficient amount of money and my sisters are all settled. And many of the parents of our brahmacharis are staying right next to the temple. There is one Krishna Dham apartments in Pune where more than 25 to 30 parents are staying. And the parents are very happy seeing their son as a dedicated brahmachari. They hear their son giving classes to thousands of people. Parents themselves, they applaud, they appreciate. Like one of our boys from Pune, he is the president of the Kanpur temple, ISKCON Kanpur temple. So his parents went to ISKCON Kanpur. They saw the 14-acre land. And they saw the guest house, they saw the huge temple. There is a very big temple, there is an 80 crores temple. And there are hundreds of, thousands of devotees visiting there. The father and mother had tears in their eyes. They said, "Son, my son, you are doing such a good job. You are leading such a big community here. We are proud of you." You are actually, they were saying that, you know, North India, as you know very well, people, you know, propagate this Hanuman Chalisa. Also Ramayana Katha, Bhagavad Katha, and all it goes. So when the parents saw that this intelligent son who is an MBA, you know, he's propagating through the mass media, you know, spiritual sound vibration, and the whole world is suffering from, you know, impure material vibration. And you are actually, your youngsters as well as the community members are all reaching out to so many people. You are protecting the cows. They have a goshala. You have such a nice spiritual books being distributed. And children are being trained in good sanskaras. Youths are being trained in Vyasan Mukta Jeevan, very pure habits and everything. Parents are very, very jolly. They stayed there for a few days. They said, "If you are simply an MBA working in a company, we won't be so happy as much as when we see you leading such a wonderful project and doing great, larger good to the society. Sarve janaha sukhino bhavantu, sarve santu niramaya, sarve bhadrani pashyantu, ma kashchit dukkha bhavet." You know, may the wicked become virtuous. May the virtuous become tranquil. May the tranquil become free. And may those who are free set others free. Isn't it? So, it's such a good work it is. So, in this way, many parents come and tell me, "We are very joyful to see our son doing this type of service." In Pune, we have a vice president, Revati Pitipu. His parents are in Pune. His father himself gives charanamrit, comes to the temple. His mother is coming for seva to the temple. So, actually, there are only a small fraction of parents who have opposition. Or maybe I can say 2%, 1%. That is because of the son's irresponsible behavior. Not because of any other reason. Actually, responsible sons make sure that they take care of the parents. Even I myself, although I had 3 sisters and I am the only son, I have been in regular touch with my sisters' children, my parents on phone, and I visit the home also regularly, take care of them. My father was telling, "I'm really proud of you. Although you are a busy man traveling across the globe, you always keep an eye on your sister's families and children and encourage them, guide them." And my father got old. He was 84, mother was 80. They both actually wanted to shift to Pune, although they were in South India. They don't know local language here, Hindi. But still they said, "We are very happy to be next to the Krishna temple." So they took a house watching the temple go open. My father spent his last 6 months in Pune and left his body. And in this way, not only my parents, I'm telling you, my mother also. My mother was coming every day to temple, morning, evening. And she made friends with a lot of devotees in Pune. So in this way, the parents actually get a very glorious opportunity to grow in Krishna consciousness through their sons and daughters who are practicing. So our moment is a very, very moment with tremendous positive energy. We are not people who teach people to give up the relationships and escape from the relatives. We actually tell, therefore in Hindi we say, kuchodana nahi, jodana. We say, connect everybody to Krishna. That is the way we have been training people. And also the people who join, say India has 120 crore population. If you take, so even if we take 1% of the population becoming saintly people, how much it should be? 1 crore at least. 1 crore. Yeah. Are there 1 crore sadhus in India? If you take all the sadhus in ISKCON sadhus, it will not even be 5,000 in India. So where is 1 crore? Where is 5,000 is how much percentage of 120 crore? Think about it. It is not even 0.1%. It's less than 0.01. So why do people make such a big human cry? I don't understand for this. If that small percentage of saintly people are not there, where will this country go to? India is actually a land of saints. It's a land of Shripad Ramanujacharya, Shripad Madhvacharya, Shripad Shankaracharya, Tukaram, Narsim Mehta. India is a land of saintly people, great saintly people. So one mother was telling me, I'm so proud to see my son as a saint, following in the footsteps of the great saints of India, Mahajano Yenagata Sapanta. So, but there are a few parents who make a big human cry. We don't discourage them. We tell them, take your son. Your son is here. Son is first the property of mother and father. We don't take anybody against the parents. We tell the parents, take him home. If you are convinced in his training program here, you send him. Otherwise, we will not take him. We have done that for a few people. Yeah. And then the boy goes home. Parents see that he's very, very sincere. Stays for 6 months, 1 year at home. And then he comes with the permission of the parents. Yeah.
Oh, so you're saying that they need the parents' consent.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. In fact, even for our 1 year course, which we do, Yellow Brigade first year, they have to take permission for the course and come. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Overall,
yeah.
Do you see you have been doing youth outreach from the 1996 roughly. So we're 2020 now. Yeah. The world has changed significantly in the last 20 years, especially with the spread of the internet.
Yeah.
So have you had to do some adaptations in your youth outreach?
We do a lot.
Do you see the receptivity increasing for spirituality, or the distractions increasing and the receptivity of spirituality decreasing because of that? Or how are things happening?
Yeah, actually, the taste for spirituality has also increased a lot in the recent past, especially during the COVID time. People have become very inquisitive. Like I did one course called Gita Rahasyam. Thousands of people participated. Now, I heard that many other temples also started. Similar 18-day program. And they are actually connecting to lakhs of people, actually. Now, during this COVID period. And also, as you rightly said, times have changed. In my times, we never had even a mobile also. We had only a landline. Slowly, the mobiles came over a period of time. Now, there are a lot of things which people do through, media, like WhatsApp, and Twitter, Facebook, and things like that. But actually, I have not, in our style of teaching, as I told you, we are actually looking for people who are very strongly inclined to spirituality. So we don't too much focus attention on spreading a very wide net. We don't do that. We actually do only in the beginning, a little bit. And then after we do one or two such programs, after that we have a very clear-cut 6-session program. And then subsequently, 3 camps we hold. In 1 year period or so, people come to 16 hours of chanting Hare Krishna. So our focus is mainly on the serious practitioners. Now, somebody may say, if you do that, then what will happen to the rest of the world? Will they not get neglected or something? But there are many other devotees who actually are doing large-scale outreach also. There are many people who are in YouTube, they're heroes. Even in ISKCON, I'm telling you. Like we have Amogilla Prabhu, we have Amarendra Prabhu, we have Gauranga Prabhu, even yourself. We have many other preachers like that who are actually reaching to lakhs and lakhs of people. The large number of population also get, like your Gita daily actually goes to lakhs of people actually. And your lectures also, podcast and everything goes. So I feel that there are many preachers who are reaching out to large number of people. In fact, from that large outreach, some people may become interested to be put through the training programs and all. And so I would say that my strength or my focus has been always designing courses. Like Discover Yourself. Then after that, there's a game PT, we call it. Gita for All Made Easy. Positive Thinker Course. We have In fact, and even for those who are organizing our voice centers, we have a management course also called as email, we call it. Efficient Management and Inspiring Leadership, EMAIL.
Okay.
So that is a 32-session course, 2 hours each. So we have training program for that. And then we have another program called SLATE, we call it. Servant Leaders, Applied Training and Education. So this is about, 60 topics. Each topic is 6 hours, you know. So therefore, our training programs are all for serious people. And those people who are really keen to take such ongoing training. And therefore, of course, on YouTube, we have certain lectures going on for the mass of people also. But that we don't put too much energy in that.
Hmm.
Yeah. We are actually looking for people who are actually looking for spirituality. And we screen them out and only take them. We have even IQ, EQ, SQ test also we have. So actually, why we do that, I'll tell you. It is better to get interested people than get people interested. Yeah. Otherwise, what happens? Both will suffer. Like, I am trying to induce spiritual inclination in somebody and they are not interested. It becomes like a snake is unable to swallow a frog and both are suffering. Frog is half inside, half outside, waving his hands and legs, and snake is also not able to swallow him. So both teacher and student will suffer from that. So we are looking for interested people who are actually looking for knowledge of Gita, Bhagavad Gita. Therefore, some of our recent courses we are giving directly on Gita, Bhagavad Gita. We're telling them this is what we are teaching. If you want to come, you can come. Yeah.
That's true. So, you're talking about the internet. Even online, there are a lot of people who are directly searching for spirituality also. Like, what is the meaning of the Bhagavad Gita? How can I apply the Bhagavad Gita? There are people who are interested in utilitarian spirituality, but there are also people interested in direct spirituality also.
Yeah.
So we need a structured way of reaching out to them. And I think you have a lot of attractive acronyms also for all the courses. That is something which you have been doing from the beginning, base and voice and now email and all those. Gita made easy for everyone. Game. That's also
Gita
very
creative. Gita for all made easy. Gita for all.
All made easy. Okay.
G-A-M-E. Yeah.
That's very attractive. So overall, when you are reaching out to youth like this, and from the youth, a whole community is building. Do we also try to build bridges with, say, universities, and where we are doing our programs, and say, or we don't want to attract? Are our programs like parallel to the university, or we are also doing something within the universities where we are going?
Actually,
if we could actually spiritualize the education itself. Yeah. If you could provide some spiritual impetus within the mainstream educational system, that would reach a much broader reach of people than what we do in parallel, in separate initiatives.
Yeah. See, when we go inside the university, the number of students are enormous. Like, for example, in the first year, about 1,000 students are joining. And we will need many teachers to teach them, number one. Number two, another challenge we face is what? When you go to university, they will need very elementary type of knowledge for the students, like secular, very basic knowledge, like how to harness the mind power and how to develop good habits. We teach without the core spiritual knowledge, these topics are superficial for them. They may attend. We have courses like a dozen topics we have, which we are ready to offer for the first year students. And first students attend once in a month, they attend, and at the end of the year, we give them a certificate. They take certificate and go, We have done such kind of courses also. So now, then what? After that, now how many students will you be able to reach? I'll tell you, for example, I was teaching 8th and 9th standard students in value education in one of the schools. I found that the children are sometimes mischievous. They're naughty. They make sounds in the class sometimes. Sometimes they don't keep quiet. They disturb the other students also. Then we changed our style. What we did, instead of teaching values to all the children, we make a colorful pamphlet and we give it to all the children to go and give the pamphlet to parents at home, discuss with the parents and come back and register for the course. In each class, about 5 or 10 children register in, 6th, 7th, 8th, 9th standards. And then those interested children who are registered, for them, we need a program. They are really keen, interested. So therefore, in the schools also, in colleges also, we prefer conducting our programs for the interested students who have voluntarily chosen to come for the program, instead of doing it as a mandatory program for an uninterested lot.
Okay.
Yeah, because ultimately, see, you know very well, nowadays, even tuition, home tuitions, how they do? They advertise in the net, and here is a teacher, here is a student. And then the demo is given by the teacher. If the student likes the teacher, teacher-student match is happening, then the tuition thing happens. In the same manner, we feel that some students who are inclined to spirituality, we now, overall, even Krishna says that, manushyanam sahasreshu, kashit atisdiyatam visiddhanam kashin mameti tatvatah. So, out of 1,000 people, one is inclined to spirituality, Krishna says. And out of those thousands of such people, one can understand in truth. So now, will it not be discouraging to the monks and the preachers when Krishna says this? Oh, number is going to be small. Therefore, we don't get into the number game. Because I know very well, like I am one person in Pune here. I came in 95. And I became a president in 97 now. Simply, I have to stay in Pune and practice spiritual life so that many, many, many people will come, connect, you know. They'll connect to the temple, they'll connect. And I have to make sure that my orientation is to take care that I simply become a transparent instrument via media in the hands of Srila Prabhupada and my guru. And I act as the, whatever they want to give to society, I act like a transparent glass to give it to the people. And then take the respect of the people and give it to them. So if one person is acting like this, he can actually touch so many people. Same way, later on, one becomes sannyasi. He can do even more. When one becomes a spiritual master, he reaches to lakhs and crores of people he can reach like this. So therefore, I'm never bothered about the number, which may be sometimes smaller. And that is the reason I also, in order to increase the number, we have actually expanded ourselves to various centers. We have sent. But although we have expanded various centers, I'm still in touch with many of the preachers. Monthly once we meet for a couple of hours. We have, we call it the Vrinda groups, we call it. Like, for example, 60 preachers come together in one forum. So we have several forums, Bliss Forum, Gloss Forum, Vrinda Forum, like that I have forums. Where I meet two hours, different groups of leaders who are preaching in different parts of the country. So we all gather, we discuss together, and we do both. We discuss spiritual subject also that will nourish the leaders and make them strong leaders. And we also discuss practical ways by which we can perform better in our service. As we do both. So in this way, the preaching expansion is taking place. Like one example, I'll tell you, Bangladesh. In Bangladesh, there are 42 voice centers in Bangladesh.
42 voice centers, amazing. Yeah.
And they have translated all our voice books into Bengali. And all these courses are going on there. They conduct the same courses, Sankalp, Purti, Utkarsh, they conduct it. And all the top leaders, I visit Bangladesh 1 week in a month, I mean 1 week in a year. Just I go for 1 week program, I go. But other times they are in touch with us through email and other things. So, and youth preaching is happening very, very powerfully there. And that land is the holy land. Rakshatra Mahaprabhu's justice there. So many, many acharyas are born there. So how this can be scaled, you can see. In the same manner in India also, like in Pune, we are preaching to 25 colleges, 25 centers. Now, if you ask in Hyderabad, if you ask in Bangalore, if you ask in Calcutta and Kanpur and Dharwad and Juhu, and other places where we have sent devotees, they're all doing very well. Everybody is expanding very nicely. So everywhere we are doing similar type of preaching only, quality preaching. We may get a small number of people. But if you see the number of centers, in each center we get small, small groups of people. The total is a big, big number. Yeah. Like coming year, we are going to celebrate the Silver Jubilee, 25th year of Pune, our voice preaching. So I told them recently to take a survey of how many people have become fixed up in our devotees and those who are connected to our centers. They said about 2,300 people have been 16 rounders who have been fixed up, stable devotees who are continuing. Yeah. And there are also many others, who have got disconnected from us, but they are in different parts of the world also. Yeah. So we may... And lakhs of people are approached, if you see, several lakhs have been approached for the one-time programs. like OTP or an impact program, we call it in the colleges. And that is also a welfare activity because that also ultimately reaches good vibrations to many, many people. And also inside the college also, there are some clubs like Dhruva clubs or the SWC, we call it, it's called a student welfare club, which are actually run by a group of youth who are inspired by our programs. And then they take lead in the college and they like these four regulative principles. You know, no meat eating, no gambling, no intoxication, no illicit sex, and chanting one round. So some of them are doing it, and then they are actually administrating many programs, and we actually offer them support of preachers, you know, those who can give sermons and not like that. Like we did one program for ABVP, group of people. We did one for the NSS also, we did programs for them. So many colleges actually request us to give programs, especially for the leaders, because they want the leader to have the character as their spine. Because without the character, many leaders are falling prey to vices. If you don't become wise, then we will suffer from vices.
Yes.
Therefore, they are beginning to understand it. So I gave one program on servant leadership, these kind of programs. I also have a great desire that in the time to come, I have designed a few courses for MBA students, which can be done in the college on leadership, teaching them servant leadership, that type of topics, which could be taught to the MBA students. So we have some plan in the coming future. At least we want to do some programs inside the college campus for like elective subjects. They can choose like elective. It will be affiliated to Pune University. Yeah. So Gauranga Prabhu is coming up with the BRC, Bhaktivedanta Research Center. So through that, we may get affiliation from Pune University for conducting some courses inside the college that we may not be doing, but there are many congregation devotees. Already we have done in a few colleges, and that we want to expand in a big way so that students who may not take the specialty very seriously also will be benefited.
That's amazing. So over the years, as you said, through multiplier effect, the multiple levels of people are being benefited.
Yeah.
And so how do you see our movement as it is expanding in the broader country? Do we see in the near future, you said that you would like to have something like 50 celibates and 1,000 community members in every community. So in India, do you see the overall trend as optimistic, or because there is so much westernization or so much distraction for various reasons? So do you feel overall the way things are going now, do you feel optimistic about the future, or do you feel that it's Kali Yuga and things are going to go down, or how do you see the future basically?
No, actually, as per scriptures also, when Bhakti Mata goes abroad, Videsham Gachami, she says, she goes, and then Bhakti comes back to India. And after, there is going to be a Bhakti explosion all over the world for the next 10,000 years. Now only 500 years are over. Next 9,500 years, it's going to be a big Bhakti explosion all across the globe. And that is going to happen. It's already predicted in the scriptures. And also Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also has predicted it. Nostradamus has predicted it. So there are many prophecies about how the spirituality is going to expand in the world. I see that although materialism sometimes rears its ugly head repeatedly, it is not last longing. It is a repeating theme we have seen in this world. Materialism increases and people get slaps and kicks and punches and everything, and then again it goes down. And then people turn to spirituality. For example, before the COVID times, you can see that man was headlong going in materialism, but during COVID time, people have turned to spirituality in a big way in many, many places. All across the country, we are getting roaring response for children program, for youth program, for congregation program, everywhere. All temples are reaching out to hundreds and thousands of people now. So, and also I am seeing that people have become more open. Recently one of the organizations had invited me. I generally give them 10 topics, corporate topics. So I had given them, but they chose this topic. We want to learn learning leadership tips from Hanuman's Lanka trip. That is the topic they chose. So I asked them, is it all right? They said, oh, everybody wants it. You know, we don't want stress management, time management. You know, we have heard it a million times from so many organizations. Now many are saying teachers from Ramayana, teachers from Mahabharata, teachers from Srimad Bhagavatam, they are developing a lot of faith now that the scriptures are having a lot of valuable tips for the leaders, to apply in their lives. Therefore, recently I had published a couple of books, one called Art of Smart Work and Stress the Mind, two books. And I wanted to produce some 10 books like that, which I could conduct in companies. But these are all actually, character development and leadership skills development based on scriptures like Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam. So one of my two goals I have in this corporate programs, one is to teach the people that most of the ideas you learn from self-help books, they are only in tidbits that they are offering you. The original source is the scriptures, like Gita, Bhagavata, Mahabharata, Ramayana. They go to the root of the problem. But self-help books may help you to superficially, find out a mental adjustment. Whereas scriptures teach you to go to the root of the problem. Therefore, go to the scriptures. That is one of the goals. Second goal is to teach people that the Supreme Lord Krishna or Rama or Vishnu, they are the embodiment of oceanic sublime qualities. And like Krishna, the mentor, I have 10 clips which I have put it in leadersvoiceindia.com. There I have uploaded it, leadersvoiceindia.com. And I will be uploading many more such clips. Why? Because these clips show clearly, video clips, they show that Lord actually is a first-class leader. He is empathic in understanding problems. He's a friendly leader, empathic leader. He's a philosophical leader, understanding leader, encouraging leader. So this type of so when people see that, they get twin advantage. One is they get some tips how to become a good leader, and they develop affection for the Lord also. So in this way, they develop attraction for Lord Krishna, Lord Rama. And also they also develop faith in scriptures as the basis for all scriptures as the basis for getting ideas for effective leadership and management. Even all the 32 topics I do in my email course, they're all based on Srimad Bhagavatam and the Chaitanya Charitamrita. Yeah, I use that as the basis. So then people say that my administration, my leadership management in my company is interwoven with my real life. They feel that it's not compartmentalized. Not that I have to put a facade in the office and I am a different person at home and I have different, you don't have multiple identities. You will be like Janak Maharaj, or one will be like Ambarish Maharaj, Yudhishthir Maharaj. For them, everything is imbued with spirituality. So they
Beautiful.
will learn that. Yeah.
Yes. You can, on a concluding note, can you tell something about your books, various books which you have written, and because you have written a lot of books, what inspired you and how they contribute to your vision for outreach?
Yeah, actually, when I prepared one of the first books I prepared was Discover Yourself, which is now much, much more evolved. Now over the years, now if you go to dys.radheshyamdas.com, I have uploaded the recent PPTs also there. DYS stands for Discover Yourself. So it is 8-session course now. The book is also getting refined now. And the PPTs are much more simplified now, very easy to use for anybody. And that has become an internationally acclaimed course because youths across the globe, where you find it very logical and very scientific, very reasonably presented. And the spiritual subject matter is presented in a way that youths can grasp it very easily. They can appreciate it with a lot of video clips and everything like that. Like I have taken some videos from Discovery Channel, and I have also quotes from Einstein and many other scientists like that. So they find a blend of science and spirituality. And after they complete that book, I had a series of books called as Essence of Bhagavad Gita, 5-volume edition. Now that is the series of volumes I'm modifying under another name now called Gita for All Made Easy. Again, this Gita for All Made Easy, why I am changing it, the reason is I had in those days, questions for which they have to write exhaustive answers. But now I am converting them into multiple choice questions, easy to answer. that kind of questions I'm making it. So, and I'm also making the lessons more lucid. So I've been polishing these books. And apart from that, I had one series called Spirituality for the Modern Youth. After the Discover Yourself, there is a Your Best Friend, there is Your Secret Journey, Victory Over Death. So these books have multiple articles which will reinforce the spiritual faith of the students. Apart from our regular courses, these are like self-study books which students can read. Students who are serious about spirituality, they read these books. And there are some small pocket books like Stress to Smile, Art of Smart Work. So there are a few pocket books like that. So those pocket books are easy to read. So many, many people tell me even today, the Art of Mind Control in those days had published a book. He must have printed about probably, 50,000 to 1 lakh books must have gone, over the years, because it goes like hotcakes. Used to sell it in 5 rupees since the early days. So people, it's like, we can say like appetizer, we can say. When they buy a small book, when they read it, wow, it's interesting. Now I want something more. What is it? Take Bhagavad Gita. I can give that. Then the Bhagavad Gita is bulky, but they will want to read it because now they developed interest now. So that is the goal of the pocket books. Yeah. So these are the things currently I've been doing. And now I understood that although I'm making these books, many people across the globe may not be getting it. So nowadays I'm making these sites like dys.radhishyamdas.com. That's one. And the leadersvoiceindia.com, I told you. So these are sites where I upload the videos as well as PowerPoints. Anybody can download. And I forgot to tell one very important goal of my very existence is to actually assist the preachers across the globe in providing them materials. Like, for example, Gita Rahasyam, 18 PowerPoints are there. Bhagavata Rasamalayam, there are 19 PowerPoints for 19 chapters in the first canto. And in the same manner, Discover Yourself, PowerPoints. So one of the goals is to make books and as well as PowerPoints and videos, which can be used by the preachers themselves. And I am very, very sure if preachers get these materials and they use it and they feel some gratitude and they bless me, and that will help me make progress in my spiritual life also. That's one of my goals in making materials available to the people. Make it very user-friendly. And many people write mails to me because of that. So not only I want to reach the students and teach them Krishna consciousness, I also want to prepare, because, as we get aged, as we get older, one of the aspects of servant leadership means a good leader is one who makes many leaders, it is said. Not only that, he should actually leave behind a legacy which will be last longing for a long, long time to come. He leaves such a spiritual influence which will not be forgotten for a long time. The materials that he leaves, the vision, mission, objectives that he has taught, it remains to people, and then they'll be able to utilize it. And the good work will go on for a long, long, several centuries it can go. So that is one of my goals in making the materials accessible. But the basis of all my materials is Prabhupada's books. I generally hear Prabhupada lectures a lot, regularly, every day I hear a few lectures. And then I take Prabhupada's lectures only and make it more simpler. And add pictures and everything and make it approachable, easy for the people. So that's one of my ambitions in life, that I become a servant of the devotees and provide them materials for preaching and make it easy, make preaching easy for them. Make it user-friendly. Like recently we made this quizzes, online quizzes for the DYS. It's become very easy now. One can go to, and same with my YouTube channel also. In YouTube channel, I had done this Chaitanya Charitamrita, the whole Madhya Leela. I completed 2 months ago, 1 month ago, I completed that. Whole Madhya Leela chapter. I went verse by verse with purports of Prabhupada also, reading it and elaborating it like that. So in the same manner, first the college youth, then the youth preachers, then the congregation preachers. So for all these people, if I can give support, and tomorrow, I'm very, very sure that if they all get some kind of assistance in their preaching, it'll be a very good service for them. Yeah. Achha. Ultimately, we are trying to please Prabhupada. If Prabhupada becomes pleased by this little endeavors, actually, Prabhupada, later on, I was surprised when I saw some of the Prabhupada's letters where I read Prabhupada says that same things what we are doing for youth preaching, Prabhupada is saying the same thing in his letters. He says, go to the universities, go to the colleges, preach to the youth, and evoke interest in them. And don't just preach one day and go away. You know, stay for a few days and create interest. And then those are inclined. Some of the intelligent men, you know, recruit them in our movement as dedicated leaders to run this movement and take this. Then our movement can go to great heights, reach the people. So it has been Prabhupada's desire. Prabhupada actually got one facility in Gorakhpur University. They were ready to give land to Prabhupada inside the university for starting a center. Many universities are now realizing it's very important for our boys to be taught from Vedic literature, like Panchatantra, Hitopadesha, Chanakya Niti, Ramayana, Mahabharata, Bhagavad Gita and all. And the beauty of this are what? They give you day-to-day, you know, usable tools also. At the same time, they are all basically from scriptures. So they are like true north. They are spotless. So therefore, I am very, very confident in the time to come. India is going to flourish in her spirituality and going to become a beacon light for the whole world in spirituality. And hundreds and thousands of preachers are emerging now. You may be aware that Gauranga Darshan Prabhu, you know, in GV has produced very good Subodhini guides, after which the culture of studying Bhagavatam all across the globe has increased now. Very, very popular. Chaitanya Charitamrita and Srimad Bhagavatam. In the same manner, GV is doing a very good laudable service in reaching across the globe. I feel that these are all actually Lord's divine orchestrations by which He is going to manifest that golden age of 10,000 years, what Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's period is supposed to happen. That's going to happen in the time to come.
That's amazing. So, you know, not only are you, see, I guess by hearing you talk, you know, you can feel infused with the missionary spirit to share Krishna Bhakti. But not only the spirit is important, but the resources are also important.
Yeah.
In one sense, the books that you are providing are like resources. If warriors are there, they need fighting spirit, but they also need weapons. So you are providing them both. It's wonderful. So usually at the end of the podcast, I try to summarize some things.
Yeah.
Summarize what we spoke. And then if you have some concluding words, you can speak those.
Yeah.
Are there any other things you would like to discuss as such? Apart from this, what you have discussed?
Yeah, actually, one very important thing that Srila Prabhupada wanted, and Prabhupada's names we have, Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschati Desha Tarine. It is said in Prabhupada's name. So the Prabhupada's desire was actually the Western. Prabhupada said he had two ambitions he had. One ambition is to make all Americans into Vaishnavas. And the second ambition is to make the whole world Vaishnavas through those Americans. Prabhupada said these were his two ambitions. So now due to the new age invasion, now there has been a great scanty population of people becoming very dedicated, serious devotees. So in the recent past, there has been a lot of discussion about, many of the leaders are talking about how in the West there could be very good preaching expansion. So that is one of my prayers and one of my longings, to see that not only good preaching happens in India, which is naturally a Punya Bhumi, you know, people are naturally spiritually inclined. But in the Western world also, we need to generate large number of devotees like Prabhupada did in his times. In Prabhupada's times, there were 10,000 devotees, I heard, 5,000 initiated and 5,000 were aspiring from Prabhupada. So one Prabhupada in his old age did what a magic or a miracle. So I would pray that, you know, in the West also, in future, we want to see many of the Indians, you know, those are very stable in their spiritual life, go to the West and assist in the mission of Srila Prabhupada, giving the taste of Krishna consciousness to the Westerners, not just the taste of vegetarian food, or not just the taste of Indian culture of wearing sari or just wearing dhoti, or the Indian cuisine or yoga, but along with all any other Indian attractive thing, culture for them, the spirituality, especially the Krishna conscious philosophy, the esoteric philosophy of Krishna consciousness teaches us, you know, what Lord Chaitanya came to give, cultivating the feelings of loving separation from Krishna. So this is one of my the most deepest longings. Even if I don't get to do, I would like to see many, many Indians taking this, giving the Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's sublime teachings to the people of the West. I think this is the need of the hour now. because America is a first world country and they are extremely influential all across the globe. And I'm very happy to see you doing a lot in America. You have influenced the professors and writers and, you know, many of the philosophers and everybody in the West through your lectures and everything. And I wish to see that happening more and more. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you for your good wishes. Yes, I think Western outreach is a big frontier for us to move forward. And you have also been doing quite a bit in terms of visiting there and establishing youth centers. So yes, there's a lot to be done. So I'll try to summarize quickly. So we discussed broadly the theme of youth outreach as the basis for community building, as well as we can say broadly world transformation.
Yeah.
Started with your inspiration about how you had very good values and devotional upbringing. And then especially in colleges, when you saw that it was very superficial, people who came from good background also were not necessarily living authentically. And then when you saw Western people taking up bhakti so seriously, so in one sense, Indians were practicing superficially, but Western people were practicing so seriously. And that inspired you to yourself become a missionary. And your father told you
My spiritual master himself, he was a 19-year-old boy when he came to India.
Yes.
Ranganath Swami Maharaj. You know, he was born in Chicago. He came in the age of 19 years and he was touched by the, you know, culture of Vrindavan Dham, where everybody is the mood of a servant. Huh? And so eventually he surrendered his life to Prabhupada. So and after I got to meet him personally and seeing his commitment and dedication and purity and his preaching expansion, that was one of my great inspirations to get initiated by him in 1993. And then followed by preaching. He has been always my great guide in my life, because every year I get to meet him 2-3 times for an hour or two each time. And I report to him and also take guidance from him on how I can serve better. And therefore, he himself is from the West. And he did miracles in India by his preaching. Now he's trying to do miracles in the West also. Yeah.
Yes. So... Thank you. So you already in the childhood wanted to be in a Gurukul and learn Sanskrit, but your father said that first get academic education, mainstream education, and then if you want to do this, you can do this. So you felt...
My father said, if you are academically qualified, then people will listen to you.
Yes.
Then it will get better.
That's true. Even when I first heard from you, the fact that you were a IIT graduate, that was quite impressive. So then... You basically were doing some kind of youth outreach even when you were working in Thermax in Pune. Then you came to Mumbai and started writing Spiritual Scientist, and then came back to Pune. After it was remarkable, just after 1.5 years of being in the ashram, you were sent as a leader of a different project entirely, and as a youth leader at least. And then from there, things expanded. So the whole idea of Voice, I think the youth center base, or later it was called Voice, I think that is one of the most transformative contributions of yours. Many contributions, but that has really provided a structure that can be widely adopted and replicated for doing youth outreach. And the fact that you mentioned a community of 5,000 congregation and over 500 celibates, that's unprecedented in the history of our movement. And so all that has resulted from youth outreach. So if you place cultivating devotees right in the beginning, and that's like putting the horse first, then everything else will follow. And then even when we take care, we have youth. So the obstacles that the youth face are, some of them are distracted by media madness. Some are very stressed out by the demands of the academic pressures. Others are obsessed with going abroad and having a better life. So amid all this, there are a significant number of pious students children coming from pious backgrounds who want to live a good value-centered life. And so if we focus on those interested people, there is a significant number. So you said that the Voice lifestyle, which is regulated with healthy food, healthy habits, that helps them
It's called Jet Age Gurukul.
Jet Age Gurukul. That's a beautiful word. Yeah. So that Jet Age
Gurukul. One leg in the college, one leg in the center. So they earn an engineering degree or medical degree. Along with that, they also earn a spiritual degree.
Yes. So it takes care... It provides them a steady material foundation by which they can take up spiritual life seriously. And not only do they become spiritually committed, but also they become materially more competent because of their regulation and discipline. And what was especially significant, I felt, is that we encourage them to become responsible, that you know, they take care of family responsibilities, and that very moving stories of a whole apartment of devotee brahmachari's parents staying near the temple and appreciating and being proud of their children, sons who have now become temple leaders and leading big projects. So that is, I think, a significant misconception remover, you know, that what you shared over there. Then further, we talked about when you're doing youth outreach, the focus is on providing engagement for everyone. So that's why, even if you're focusing on, as you said, get interested people rather than get people interested. So if in each place, there may be a small number of interested people. But if you go to many places, then overall, there is a multiplier effect and we get dedicated people. So we focus on quality and we, in one sense, reach, go out to a lot of places. So then we get quantity also in the long run. And overall, if each temple had, that numbers are significant, you know, 50 and 150, 50 celibates and 1,000, 50 brahmacharis, 1,000 dedicated grihasthas, then our outreach could radically expand. And it's already happening through Pune and so many other places. And also you discussed how there are structured programs through for various age groups. And also for the students as they come forward through one-time programs and youth. So I think this structure and clarity of structure of process and the clarity of purpose, I think they are very significant defining features of what all you have been doing. And then towards the later part we discussed, there is every reason to be optimistic because spirituality is growing. Although you said a nice point that materialism goes up and comes down because people eventually get infatuated, but they eventually get frustrated. Mm-hmm. And so while focusing on those serious people who are interested in serious spirituality, there is also a trickle-down effect where others also get benefited.
Correct.
So especially what you talk about, I loved the idea of, you know, teaching servant leadership by using the Lord's example. So they learn values for good leadership, but they also develop appreciation for the Lord. And there is receptivity in that sense. So if it is presented in a value additional way, not in a sectarian way, then it is a lot of receptivity. So
like Forbes Marshall, they gave me the topic Krishna the mentor.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
that's remarkable. Okay. No. So then also, you have very attractive play of words also. What was it? That leadership tips from Hanuman's trip.
Yeah.
That's very good play of words. And of course, great acronyms like Gita for all made easy and game. So through all of these, what is happening is you said that we can be very optimistic. The 10,000 year prophecy of Lord Chaitanya is becoming manifested and being fulfilled. And we all can become instruments in that. So your specific legacy that you try to leave is that create dedicated devotees and then provide resources for devotees so that they can do outreach. So those are several of your books are resources like that. And especially during COVID, you said that a lot of people like Gita Rahasyam and others, devotees and new people are appreciating that. And lastly, our Western outreach, you mentioned that there is a need for that. And Indians, like Prabhupada was one Indian who did so much in the West. So in future, you can hope that further some Indians can also contribute to Western outreach. And that way, that is really significant. I had not heard that Prabhupada wanted Americans to become Vaishnavas and then Americans to make the whole world Vaishnavas. Mm-hmm. Wonderful. And overall, I feel that was very attractive translation of Sarvejana Sukhina Vantu. What did you say that may the wicked become
virtuous, may the virtuous become tranquil, may the tranquil become
free,
may the free
set others. That is beautiful. It's a very universalized explanation of that verse. So I feel this combination of spiritual wisdom and proper structured implementation that has a very powerful potency for transforming. And that's what you talked about, this Tata also, the teachers, administrators, traders, and artisans. So especially teachers and administrators, they are going to be the leaders, influencers of society, leaders of society. So if we can help them become spiritualized, then if we can say spirituality for teachers, religiosity for lead administrators, then
morality,
morality, honesty, and then loyalty.
Yes.
So we can have, in one sense, very spiritual, even if a small significant number of people become spiritual and a larger number of people develop some values, that can actually help create a much better world and usher in the golden age. Thank you very much.
Large number of people talking about morals and values without that top two categories of people strongly rooted in spirituality. If that is not there, then this mass of people talking about morality will not last for a long time. Although a lot of organizations are now talking about values, morality, character, importance and all that, you know, being good and doing good and all that. But that will be very hollow without few people in the world very strictly showing the true north principles of spirituality. And that's very vital. So our goal is summarized, I can summarize my talk with two phrases for our voice. The motto of our voice is rekindling wisdom, reviving love. So love is of the heart, and wisdom, you know, we gain knowledge and then it turns into wisdom. So rekindling wisdom and reviving love. So when wisdom is revived, gradually one becomes more and more realized to a point where one's heart blossoms with love. Love for God and love for all. So that is actually the goal of all our training programs. And one person I would very gratefully remember now is His Grace Antardweep Prabhu, who is who has been like my younger brother, right next to me. And all the materials which I'm preparing, I'm very, very haphazard and protecting all the materials what I'm making, because in computer I have thousands of files and I'm very poor in keeping records. But he is one person, very meticulous, very attentive in putting everything in records and making it in a way available to all the preachers and everybody. I'm extremely grateful to him, because without him, now he is the chairman of Voice now. I have been a director of Voice for many years, but I made him the chairman of Voice. I see him as a very capable successor who actually knows in and out of whatever I spoke. He actually lives it, and he exactly translates into action whatever I request of him. So I am very, very grateful to him. Without him, I would be handicapped, I can say honestly. Because I many times do many good things, but I'm not a very good, I don't keep proper records, registers. And also I'm very poor in modern day media, that like in terms of, you know, now, as you rightly said, the media, new things have come up now. And I use a simple, you know, this is my phone. This is a button phone I use. You know, I use it only for receiving phone calls and making. I never use a smartphone also. So therefore, having Antardweep Prabhu on the team of, we call it as a Brahmachari Voice Preachers. And also there is one group called as, a bigger group called as Royal, we call it. So Royal stands for actually Rajarishi Outreach, you know, youth. Rajarishi Outreach, R-O-Y-A-L, we call it. Actually, L stands for leaders, association actually. Royal Outreach Youth Association for Leaders. Actually, Youth Association of Leaders. Actually, these leaders are all youth preachers in different parts of the world. They all come together, and I'm very grateful to them too, because they are in the field. They are actually managing and preaching and bringing success for Prabhupada's mission. I'm very, very grateful to them. Although I may talk many things, I put many things in paper, but the translators are other devotees who are putting their sweat and toil in making nice things happen. I'm grateful to every one of them. And thank you for the opportunity, Chandran Prabhu, for helping me to think aloud about what we are doing. And also sharing these things with you, I'm sure will also give me more opportunity to contemplate and make our service better for the welfare of the world. And I have a lot of things learned from you too, because I have seen you from the early days. If you remember, you know, when you started writing articles and gradually bringing out books, and the kind of vigorous outreach that you do, I consider you like a walking, talking university. You know, it's like you are a university which carries. You have Bhakti Shastri courses. You are giving through your videos, and you're reaching out to scientists. You're reaching to philosophers. You are reaching to students. You are reaching to the even Alachua senior disciples. Prabhupada are appreciating your lectures. You are catering to the needs of different grades and levels of devotees across the globe. So seeing you, I feel what I am doing is a small iota of service, 1% of what you are doing, actually. And I wish I take that inspiration from you, and also, you know, in the time to come, do something even more tangible in terms of youth preaching, despite all my limitations. Thank you for the opportunity.
You know, it is, humility leads to an inversion of reality. So what I am doing is barely a drop of what you are doing, and I am doing it also largely by the training and systematic thinking systematic. Especially, I feel that if I have developed an approach for systematic study of philosophy and systematic presentation of philosophy, now that is largely because what I saw you doing, what I learned from you, and when I assisted you in editing some of your books, and you helped me in my writing. So I'm grateful to you personally for all that you provided me with. And over the years, you know, other services, other dharmas have called me, but
many of our students are using your FAQ book. FAQ book. Yeah. They're using it for mantra meditation groups. Yes. They're using that. They are also using many other of your books, actually, science and spirituality books also. And you actually bring out books exactly fitting the need of the hour. When recession came in the world, you brought a book on recession. After that, Y2K, sorry, this, after that, we had this
the movies.
Movie, you know, what is that movie which came?
PK and OMG.
PK. So how to respond to the false ideologies created by them, you know. So you bring books exactly. And especially your book on reincarnation, which you published. What is the name of that book? We give it as a gift for all the winners, toppers in the colleges.
Oh, okay. Demystifying reincarnation.
Demystifying reincarnation. Lot of solid scientific evidences are given in that book. Very good book it is. Yeah. So I find them very interesting. Now, actually, I'm reading your Gita daily regularly to deepen my understanding of Bhagavad Gita. There are multiple articles on even the same verse, you know. So I even make workshops for the students from your Gita daily articles. Like, you know, from weakness to victory, not weakness to wickedness.
Yes.
So this kind of...
You take some inspiration from somewhere and develop it further. Because I usually talk about weakness and wickedness. But it's nice further play of weakness to victory.
So, yes. Are you a victor or a victim? You know? So this kind of very, very beautiful, I'm getting a lot of depth in your, I see a lot of depth in your articles of Gita Daily. And I'm going to plunge deeper. And I am sure the more I learn them well, actually they are very, very fit for both two types of people. For college youth and corporate youth. For both of them. Many of these things which you are doing are very good. So therefore, in that sense, I also consider you as a very vigorous youth preacher. So like pen is mightier than the sword, we say, no?
Thank you. I see that as your blessings. I can continue my service in some small way. I'm very grateful for you to spare your time and share not just your wisdom, but also your, I would say, vision and especially your energy. I always felt that whenever I get to spend time with you, you know, that the urge to share spiritual wisdom with others, that is what we all are in one sense dedicated to that. But the energy is very evident in your words and your actions. And I feel spiritually surcharged myself. So thank you very much for your association and sharing your time and your wisdom.
Thank you.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Jai Shri Padki.